The history of the illustrious Beau Rivage Hotel is dotted with tragedy. More than a century ago, an empress died in this luxury establishment. She was staying incognito, signing the guest book under a false name. Nevertheless, everyone knew who she was. Sisi, Empress Elizabeth of Austria. On September the 10th, 1898, she was stabbed in Geneva. Her murderer was an anarchist named Luigi Luciani. He smiled as he was led away by authorities. Sisi was brought back to the Beau Rivage, where she died in the arms of the hotel owner.
This tragic event left its mark on our hotel's history. My grandmother Fanny, who was 24 then and newly married, welcomed the Empress. Even in her lifetime, Sisi was already such a mythical figure, a legend. I imagine how emotional it must have been to go from hosting this extraordinary woman to being at her side in her final moments.
De la servir et puis ensuite de l'assister dans ses derniers moments.
Empress Elizabeth was no stranger to this tranquil Swiss city.
Sisi adorait ses journées.
Sisi loved spending time on the shores of Lake Geneva. It's an exceptional place. She loved hiking in the mountains, which was very unusual for a person of her rank.
That fateful September day began like any other. A stroll, some shopping, nothing special. Just before she died, she reportedly asked, "What happened to me?"
She came for just 24 hours. Baroness Julie von Rothschild had invited her to lunch. She'd been a guest at the Beau Rivage many times before, but this was just a short visit. She dropped off her luggage and hurried off to lunch. Then she shopped and ate some ice cream. She loved ice cream.
Sissy's memory is kept alive in the halls she once walked. A showcase displays the Empress's bodice. The drops of blood have faded in the fabric with time.
This tragic loss left an imprint on our hotel, and the history was brought to light again in the post-war period, when Marischka made his legendary films about Sisi. My sisters and I all watched them, of course. We immersed ourselves in the story, knowing the ending took place in our house. It was quite traumatic for us as children to watch these films that the whole world was talking about with the knowledge that the end happened here, in our hotel.
The Beau Rivage has been owned by the Mayer family for five generations. The hotel's past and present are closely intertwined.
C'est un théâtre.
This is a theater. Sometimes the play is lighthearted, a comedy. Other times it's tragic, a drama. It's a place that's full of life. When the hotel was founded in the mid-19th century, there wasn't the same competition that exists today. My great-grandfather opened a house that respected the needs of an aristocratic clientele, a secluded kind of world. To see and be seen, that's what 19th century guests came to do here among their peers.
The reception area is modern and vibrant, teeming with activity. This hotel may pay homage to its past, but it's not stuck in it.
We want to be a family house with soul. We all really enjoy working in a house with such a rich history. But we also must move into the future, with modern technology, for example. Our guests' needs have evolved over the years, and we have to adapt to them. We also have to stay curious and observe what the competition is doing.
Merci.
Bon courage.
Bonne journée. Merci. Toi aussi.
Salut.
Hidden from the guests is a labyrinth of rooms. Staff at the Beau Rivage work swiftly to produce the sophisticated touches the hotel is known for.
They give the hotel a soul. The bouquets help to fill out the splendid rooms. Our guests really appreciate the flowers.
With just under 100 rooms and suites, the Beau Rivage manages to offer a feeling of intimacy to guests. Since the very start, celebrities have been drawn to the hotel's charm.
The stars are all different, but those who stay at the Beau Rivage embrace its values, and that means discretion. They come to hide away, so their privacy is respected. The Beau Rivage is not a stage. It's a place to live, and it's protected.
The luxury suites look out over Lake Geneva, with its landmark, the Jet d'Eau, a fountain that pumps water 140 meters high. The Beau Rivage fits right into this enchanting landscape, with the lake and the Alps.
Geneva is a carrefour, c'est un lieu de passage.
Geneva is a crossroads. The mountains cut us off, but the plains are open as far as the eye can see. People have to travel to Geneva because the lake is an obstacle. If you want to travel from the north to the south, you have to cross the lake. You can only do that via Geneva. Heading south to Italy or in the other direction over the St. Bernard Pass. Geneva is also a crossroads of thought, where great thinkers developed their theories, like Jean-Jacques Rousseau. This is also part of our history. It's reflected in the character of the people here. They welcome the whole world, learn a little bit from everyone, and yet remain themselves.
Geneva, Genève, Genf, Genevra. Say it however you like. It's considered the most cosmopolitan city in Switzerland. Located in the French-speaking part of the country, Geneva is the second largest city in Switzerland after Zurich. Two characteristics of Geneva: discretion and consistency. The words of a 1960s observer sound almost timeless.
The old town of Geneva, plain but rich. Secret millionaires live here. In Geneva, poverty is a vice, and a person who's bankrupt is a godless sinner, outcast, ostracized. The times may be changing, but not in Geneva.
Geneva is where the French reformer Jean Calvin developed his beliefs. There are still echoes of the strict Protestant doctrine of Calvinism here today.
C'est un calvinisme qui n'est pas un calvinisme de religion.
This is a Calvinism that is not religious, but a Calvinism of thought, in the spirit of reform, law, and justice. The people of Geneva can practice this because they live in a prosperous world. The city is not all that extravagant. Geneva is built on rigor and straightforwardness. We don't show off, we're discreet.
Geneva, 150 years ago. Jacques Mayer's great-grandparents left their homes in Germany. His great-grandmother came from Hanover. His great-grandfather from Swabia. Opening their own hotel in Geneva would be an adventure.
À l'origine de l'hôtel, en 1865, il n'y avait pas de chauffage central. Il faut dire qu'il n'y avait pas d'électricité ni d'eau.
When the hotel opened in 1865, there was no central heating, electricity or running water. Each room was equipped with a fireplace, and the staff carried wood upstairs and ashes back down again. It was a lot of work. This is a bill for heating material. Here we have 100 kilos of beech wood for heating and a ton of coke. Coke at that time was not what we call cocaine today. It was fuel, actually coal dust, which was formed into coal briquettes or blocks.
Albertine and Jean-Jacques Mayer. The founder's enterprising spirit still permeates the hotel, serving as inspiration. Innovation was on the couple's minds from the start. Where was the largest dining room in the city? And the first elevator? The Beau Rivage, of course. The hotel's foyer from 1908 has a neoclassical look. The decor is elegant and lavish. The illustrious guests came in droves. Actress Zara Banar was a loyal guest for decades. The Maharaja of Patiala, artist Jean Cocteau, and 007, that is, Roger Moore. Former French President Charles de Gaulle, greeted by a young Jacques Mayer and his sisters. Princesses and princes, politicians and heads of state. The hotel guestbook is filled with the signatures of stars. The American actor Burt Lancaster wrote, "One spoon stolen." If walls could talk, each floor of the Beau Rivage would have stories to tell, especially at the very top, where the hotel's most exclusive suite is tucked away. It was here that Eleanor Roosevelt, the widow of US President Franklin D. Roosevelt, changed the course of history. The year was 1947, and the former First Lady stayed in the suite while drafting a major paper for the United Nations.
On est ici dans un lieu exceptionnel où des personnages qui font le monde.
We are here in a very special place where people who have shaped the world have stayed as guests. All the heads of state, politicians, and people who participated in the great Geneva conferences. And of course, Eleanor Roosevelt, an unforgettable personality for Geneva. She was in charge of a commission to draft the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and she did it here. This is the fundamental document of the United Nations, like a guiding star.
C'est le document fondamental des Nations Unies, et c'est, si vous voulez, l'étoile du Nord, quelque part.
The city's hotels and the United Nations have a very special relationship. During state visits, hotels serve as the link between backroom politics and official announcements. It's the point between private conversations and world affairs. They're like a discreet, unofficial partner to the UN.
The most momentous international conference of the post-war era turned the eyes of the world this summer toward the tranquil Swiss capital of Geneva. The gleaming palace of nations, the Big Four, America, England, France, and Russia, met to seek an end to a decade of Cold War. Heading the Soviet delegation were Premier Bulganin and Communist Party Chief Khrushchev. Displaying Russia's planned policy of friendship, Khrushchev called Bulganin back for cameramen. Though nominally outranked by the Premier, Khrushchev appeared very much the boss. President Eisenhower, accompanied by Secretary of State Dulles, offered to exchange complete military information with the Russians in a dramatic personal appeal. But the plan was rejected by Bulganin and the President's wartime friend, General Zhukov, had left. Britain's Eden and French Premier Faure supported the daring American proposal.
It was in this hall of the United Nations that the so-called Big Four met. It was also here at the Geneva Conference in 1954 that a new chapter was set in motion for Vietnam. And it's where the Geneva Accords on Afghanistan were signed in 1988. The Palace of Nations in Geneva houses the European headquarters of the UN. How does the history of the United Nations overlap with the Hotel Beau Rivage? Hotel owner Jacques Mayer wants to know more about the US First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt's stay in his family's hotel. He has an appointment with the head archivist of the United Nations Library.
The committee to prepare the Declaration of Human Rights first met exclusively in New York. Then, in December 1947, the committee came to Geneva to approve the text, with Eleanor Roosevelt as its chairperson.
That's right.
Here we have the photograph that shows Eleanor Roosevelt holding the Universal Declaration of Human Rights.
Who chose her as chair?
U.S. President Harry Truman asked her to help formulate the Declaration of Human Rights. Some of the male delegates were not pleased at first.
Why is that?
Because she was a woman.
She was an activist, right?
Yes. There were many different committees. U.S. President Harry Truman gave her a job on a committee dealing with social issues. It was more of a representative job, a token gesture.
Et on a donné à Eleanor Roosevelt, pensant que c'était un peu une voie de garage, la représentation dans le comité des affaires sociales.
Voilà.
Et qui en fait est devenu très
important. But with the influx of refugees after World War II, social issues suddenly became pressing.
Donc elle a pris de l'ascendant, elle avait beaucoup de charisme. Donc
Eleanor Roosevelt took on the task with a lot of charisma. And she was appointed the chair of the Commission on Human Rights.
La Commission des droits de l'homme qui a été créée également à ce
moment-là.
Voilà,
d'accord.
Certains membres du comité et de la commission des
Some commission members complained about the pace, but she was determined to finish within the given time.
Validé dans les temps, donc elle a fait travailler un des délégués.
One delegate, I think from Indonesia, complained. He said, "Human rights are not respected by the Commission on Human Rights," because she made the delegates work until 7 p.m.
I'd like to know what happened at the Beau Rivage back then, because she stayed there whenever she visited. Surely there were private meetings in the hotels then as there are now.
Yes, a lot happens at these informal meetings.
This suite at the Beau Rivage is the perfect place for such private or even secret meetings. Guests can have their choice of several spacious rooms. But what happens when state guests arrive at the hotel who don't quite fit in with other top officials, and the protection of confidentiality is potentially compromised? That's where tact is crucial.
J'ai reçu il y a quelques années l'ancien secrétaire général des Nations Unies.
A few years ago, I received the former Secretary General of the United Nations, Kofi Annan. At the same time, we had a delegation here from a country that was not necessarily supposed to be directly associated with the Secretary General. So the United Nations protocol asked me to let the Secretary General in through the back entrance. Of course, I had the red carpet rolled out, between the dumpsters. I said to him, I'm sorry to receive you amid the dumpsters, but he just said, don't worry, it happens all the time in New York.
About 12,000 UN meetings are held each year in Geneva. Imagine what that means in terms of the number of guests to the city. The UN plays an important economic role for Geneva. As ever, discretion, says hotelier Jacques Mayer, is essential. Beside the Palace of Nations is a park that's closed to the public for security reasons. The so-called Quartier Nation, with its many international organizations, forms a city within the city.
Geneva became an international city in 1920 with the establishment of the League of Nations. A new train station and airport were built. Various institutions and non-governmental organizations emerged, such as pacifist or feminist associations, which today form their own international ecosystem. It's sometimes like the people here are living on two different planets within one city. But in recent years, more effort has been made to integrate these organizations into the daily life of Geneva.
The United Nations employs around 10,000 people in Geneva. But add in the NGOs and international organizations, and that number increases at least threefold. The hotels naturally benefit from this dynamic. In the cosmos of international politics and secret meetings, journalists prefer to meet their sources in hotels that are known for their discretion. They are safe places. Paola Dupras Tobias is one such journalist. Born in New York, she's an investigative reporter covering environmental issues, corruption, and money laundering. She reports for CNN and Al Jazeera, among other publications.
The international fame of Geneva comes from, I guess, two elements that are sometimes in opposition with each other. On the one hand, you have, of course, the UN, the World Health Organization, the International Labour Association, the International Red Cross, of course, that's based here. On the other hand, you have the banking sector, which is also very well known internationally. The problem is, right now, with the stories of money laundering and corruption that have been linked so closely to the banking sector here, they have brought the limelight, international limelight, to themselves unwillingly.
Such scandals have damaged Geneva's reputation. Can the city's good name be restored?
I think Geneva is really trying to surpass some of the negative aspects of this image that it projects internationally. There's a certain hope that with this new international exchange of data in what concerns the banking sector that Geneva is so well known for, that all these stories that have sullied its past will pass. I think it's trying as much as possible to maintain Geneva as an international center of negotiation, of humanitarian issues. So that is where the hope lies, that all that these bricks can sort of latch together, and that that would be how people see Geneva in the future.
For decades, Geneva has attracted not only enterprising reporters and serious journalists, but also paparazzi from all over the world. Important meetings are taking place under the roof of the Beau Rivage all the time. For hotelier Jacques Mayer, it's all about shielding and protecting, while simultaneously remaining absolutely invisible. When it comes to navigating political interests, financial ties, and image problems, Mayer is a seasoned expert.
The role of a hotelier is to remain totally neutral. And we are, after all, in a political environment that is neutral. But as far as the economy is concerned, it's different. We defend an open Geneva, a Geneva that can also play a social role. To do this, it needs prosperity. Obviously, not at all costs, but the city needs to be prosperous.
The Beau Rivage has also seen hard times. At the outbreak of the Second World War, the Swiss hotel plunged into crisis. Visitors stayed away. The pages of the guest book remained blank.
La Suisse était un pays qui a été isolé.
Switzerland was an isolated country, wedged between the blocks of the north and the south, the east and the west. It was on the border of the free zone, so people stopped visiting. And the Beau Rivage, like most hotels, closed down.
Private film footage from August and September 1939 shows troops in Paris and Normandy, the start of World War II. The camera also captured Lake Geneva, seemingly untouched by the war. But the Swiss were not truly unscathed.
That was a very difficult time. My parents, aunts, uncles, my grandparents lived outside the city and only occasionally came to air out the hotel, open the windows, and check for any flooding. Of course, it was a time that shaped my parents and grandparents. But after that, a new generation came. Businesses reopened, and many new tourists came to discover Geneva. They wanted a new life, a different life. So Geneva picked up quickly after the war. I spent all my Thursdays in this place when I was a teenager, because my father received the wine deliveries on Thursdays, wines from Bourgogne or Bordeaux. I used to help him open the crates. My job was to use a ruler and make sure that the bottles were aligned perfectly. Not even a 2 millimeter difference was allowed. My father didn't allow the wine cellar manager to help himself directly from the wine racks. Each rack had a card with the name of the wine, the origin, the vintage, the quantity, and the purchase price. But he wrote the purchase price backwards so that nobody else knew what he paid for them. To maintain an overview, he attached these cards. I spent my childhood cutting them out, which he then placed on the racks. There are the most valuable bottles. What is that one?
A Musigny from 79.
No, 79.
79.
From 1979. What beautiful bottles. Do you know the oldest bottle we have? It's not a wine, but a cognac.
A cognac?
From 1820. Napoleon just missed that one. We still have a few bottles of it. My parents bought it at an auction a long time ago.
The good wines come with a long history that the previous head sommelier or even his predecessor contributed towards. It's like a temple of wine. The bottles lie here with their dust and history. The work of a sommelier is to continue the history, which goes hand in hand with that of the hotel. I bring my knowledge and the wines that I like or discover, but I will always respect the tradition of the Bordeaux and Bourguignon wines at Beau Rivage. I hope these bottles will always remain here for the sake of legacy and future sommeliers.
Even in an establishment as carefully managed as the Beau Rivage, there are some things that a hotel owner simply cannot control or prevent. Like what happened here just over 30 years ago. This German journalist played a prominent role in the series of events. In October 1987, he discovered the former state premier of Schleswig-Holstein, Uwe Barschel, dead in the bathtub. Sebastian Knauer photographed him. The image appeared in the magazine Stern, provoking something of a scandal in Germany.
The Beau Rivage is an ideal place for interviews. Even if the hotel's management doesn't always appreciate that political interviews are conducted on their premises. You can create a good atmosphere, especially in luxury hotels, where the guest feels comfortable and can open up.
So how did the scandal happen? Sebastian Knauer had traveled from Hamburg to Geneva in the hope of conducting an interview with the former German state premier. Uwe Barschel had been accused of organizing a smear campaign against a political opponent. The journalist was hoping to meet Barschel in the bar. Barschel didn't appear. So the journalist entered his room the next day, without permission.
It was dimly lit. There was a single shoe in the hallway. There was a corridor that led to the bed. And there were other things lying about, such as pajamas, some sweets, a book by Jean-Paul Sartre. Surprisingly enough, open to a certain story that deals with suicide. The documents I was interested in were lying there, as if prepared for a journalist's visit. I wasn't sure how I should document them, So I took the papers to my photographer. I had told him to wait outside the room and let me know when Mr. Barschel returns. He was supposed to keep a lookout and warn me. On my way out, I knocked on the bathroom door. I opened the door and saw in the bathroom mirror there was a lifeless body in the bathtub. It was clear to me then that something terrible had happened.
A Stan reporter found Barschel dead in his bathroom.
Early reports suspect the politician shot himself.
A journalist found him in the bathtub, his head above the water. Apart from his shoes, Barschel was fully clothed.
That was 1987, and these things can happen. They can happen anywhere, anytime. Our role is to deal with this as a public place where children are born, a place full of life. People are born here, married here, and they die here. That's life, and a hotel is about life.
Following the German politician's death, journalists and photographers camped out for weeks in front of the hotel entrance. Inside the Beau Rivage, Swiss and German criminal investigators tried to determine whether it was suicide, a murder, or a natural death. How did the hotel deal with the aftermath? With signature discretion. The room number 317 simply no longer exists.
Here we go. Two menus with frogs, ravioli, salmon, lobster, sole, foie gras, and two orders of venison.
Dominique Gauthier is the head chef at Beau Rivage. Like his predecessor, he has a Michelin star. The restaurant Le Chaboté opened 50 years ago to the outside world. Before then, it was exclusively for the hotel guests. The products come from the lake and the mountains, both seasonal and regional.
Allez, table 8.
Quand on est jeune, on court après les étoiles.
When you're young, you chase after the stars.
Pour un cuisinier.
The Michelin star, that's just incredible for a chef, to be famous, genius. But as you get older, you realize that the most important thing is to please your guests, to be attentive. If you prioritize the customer, the stars will follow on their own. You learn that at the age of 50. For me, a table has to feel friendly. That's important. It has to look beautiful and inviting. You should feel at home. A table set like this invites you to sit down and have a meal. Appetizer for two.
Frog legs in batter. Deep fried, served with garlic milk foam, spinach sauce, and fresh basil. It's a classic dish here.
Ça, c'est les grenouilles. C'est un plat que...
These are the frogs, a dish I developed a good 15 years ago. It's on the menu every day. Many guests come for the frogs. Are the burgers ready yet? We even have fast food. In a hotel, you have to do it all.
The Beau Rivage opened more than 150 years ago. How does it preserve tradition, yet still keep up with the times?
We're fortunate to have a very loyal clientele who've been coming here for many years. Of course, we strive to take care of these customers, as well as their children, or even grandchildren, who want things done differently, and all have differing demands. It's on us to adapt to this.
The hotel manager, the florist, the head of reception. They all share the same philosophy. This house has a soul, because they give it one.
Each generation has its own way of expressing itself, even if we all maintain the same fundamental values. My father, for example, was a man who enjoyed good food. He opened the house to gastronomy and to a modern world, which was a world of businessmen. When he took over the Beau Rivage, he catered to a new generation that came to Geneva for conferences and seminars that had nothing to do with the fine society of the Belle Époque. I also had to further develop the house. The more Geneva connects with the world, the more it secures its future. That's obvious. So how will the coming generations, the fifth or the sixth, change things 40 years from now? That's what I'd like to know.
At Beau Rivage, each generation has had a hand in writing the hotel's history. From big politics to celebrity encounters, the owners have navigated every twist and turn with signature Swiss discretion. And they're ready to greet what chapter comes next.